This derogatory movie that we're discussing here today is a sequel of an earlier process which started some time back. There were derogatory cartoons, caricatures made of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and this seems to be a follow-up. And these events appear to be quite well coordinated. The mentality behind all this that we see appears to be to provoke Muslims. Now, why would the filmmakers or the Danish cartoonist opt to take this course? The reason is simple. They can preempt that the Muslims the world over will react violently and unintelligently. So I suppose the Muslim Ummah must revisit its own approach towards blasphemy. If each time a cartoon is made or a movie is made which is derogatory to the founder of Islam, if Muslims are going to react in this fashion, then this amounts to inviting these people to continue with their campaign. Muslims need to review their approach to the whole issue of responding to blasphemy. Primarily, we must remember that there is no punishment prescribed in the Holy Quran for blasphemy, which suggests that if someone is guilty of blasphemy, neither a Muslim state nor Muslims as individuals are authorized by the Quran to go around punishing the blasphemers. That is not for us to do. Blasphemy will be punished by God the Almighty when He so chooses. We are neither the judges nor the executors. So this has to be left entirely to the Almighty. Prophets of God are immune to blasphemy anyway. You see, attempting to insult a prophet, any prophet, whether it's the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam or any other prophet, is comparable to raising your face to the sky and trying to spit at the sky. And if you do so, the spit will evidently land on the spitter's own face. So if someone even attempts to insult any man of God, the insult will only return to him. And all we can do is we can put this across politely to those who seek to do this. The Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has been described in the Quran as rahmatul lil alamin. Wama arsalnaka illa rahmatan lil alamin. We have not sent you but as mercy personified for the entire world, for all worlds. The Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was mercy embodied. He was mercy itself. He neither taught violence nor did he resort to violence. The objection of the prophets raising the sword and going to the battlefield the little detail they invariably miss out is that it was defensive combat that was permitted. The Prophet ﷺ was permitted to fight back only when the aggressor had reached a point beyond which he could possibly not go. The Prophet ﷺ had suffered persecution in Mecca for 13 good years. Then he migrated to Medina. The oppressor and the aggressor did not spare the Prophet and his followers. The oppressor pursued the Prophet to Medina. A war was declared upon the Muslims who had actually left their hometown. It was then that Allah the Almighty permitted the Prophet to fight in defense as self-preservation. So it was essentially defensive combat that was permitted. Otherwise, the soul and spirit of the Prophet's teaching is rahmah, which is mercy, which is compassion. And even on the battlefield, the Prophet ﷺ exercised strict adherence to certain principles such as not engaging anyone who is a non-combatant, principles such as the elderly, the women, the children, trees, etc. will not be touched. So there was a code of ethics that was observed closely even during fierce combat. And the combat was always, as a matter of principle, defensive. There's not a single event in the Prophet's life where he initiated a battle or initiated a military conflict. We read in the Quran, Allah says that idfa billati hiya ahsan fa iza allazi bainaka wa bainahu adawatun kaannahu waliyyun hamim. Idfa billati hiya ahsan. Defend yourselves with a the best, which is most generous. And when you do this, then he between whom and yourself there exists discord, he will become your warm friend. So the Quranic teaching is that short of the battlefield, where an attack is made, we are taught to defend by means of the best conduct. We have been taught to repel evil with goodness. We have been taught to show patience. We have been taught to pray for the one who insults us. This is what the Quran teaches. Now what Muslims do is not Islam. Islam is what the Quran teaches. The Muslims may well have abandoned the Quran. So when we witness a case of the Muslims reacting in a manner which is contradictory to the Quran, the blame is not to be placed on the Quran, the blame is to be placed on those Muslims who have chosen to abandon the Quran. The Holy Prophet ﷺ withstood the fiercest form of persecution for 13 years in Mecca. His followers were tortured, they were killed. Never once did he respond. And all this he withstood with absolute perseverance, patience, with prayer. His persecutors followed him. It was then that he was allowed to fight back in defense. In Medina too, there was a person, an individual named Abdullah bin Ubay bin Sulul. This person, in my opinion, was the greatest of all blasphemers. He would insult the Holy Prophet in public. He would deride the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in public. Not once did the Prophet issue a decree regarding this blasphemer. Never was he arrested, never was he subjected to any punishment of any sort, until the person finally died a natural death. When he died, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam offered the funeral prayers, the janazah, of this greatest blasphemer. The Prophet removed his own shirt and placed it on the dead body of this greatest of all blasphemers. So this is how the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam responded to blasphemy. If there is any conduct that Muslims must acquire, it should be the conduct of the founder of Islam. And the founder of Islam forgave the greatest of all blasphemers, and not only forgave him, but walked the extra mile to show extra compassion towards this truly despicable person. This movie has been made by an individual who belongs to the Coptic Church, which means that the movie maker is a Christian by faith. And in his movie, he seems to have raised questions about the birth of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and has tried to raise doubts on the legitimacy of the Prophet's birth. I find it amusing that this Christian did not think of the possibility of Jesus's illegitimate birth, based upon the facts that Jesus had no father. So it seems to be an effort made by someone who was completely bereft of rationality. The issue of freedom of speech has been highlighted in defense of this movie maker, and in defense of the earlier cartoons that were made by a Danish individual. You see, freedom of speech, while it may be a right, brings along with it certain responsibilities. When an individual chooses to exercise his freedom of speech, he has to remember that he is not living on another planet of the solar system. He is sharing this space and time with other individuals. If he is living in a society, he has to cater for the sensibilities of others around him. Decency itself is a responsibility that has to be taken care of. And somehow, when we examine the cases of this cartoonist and this movie maker, we see that the right to freedom of speech is being demanded without the responsibility of exercising simple decency. The primary and foremost form of jihad is seeking union with God. Then you have preaching of the Quran. That is a jihad. Then the struggle against one's own ego is a form of jihad. Spending in the way of God, giving out alms, charity, is also a jihad. And the last in line is the jihad of defensive combat. When the Holy Prophet ﷺ was returning from Khaybar, he said to his Sahaba, now in Khaybar they had fought a battle and won, and now they were returning to Medina, where there was no conflict going on in Medina. They were returning from a battlefield to a peace zone. And the Prophet ﷺ said that رَجَعْنَا مِنَ الْجِهَادِ الْأَصْغَرِ إِلَى الْجِهَادِ الْأَكْبَرِ, that we returned from the smallest form of jihad to the greatest form of jihad. The smallest form of jihad was defensive combat, which they were leaving behind them. And the greatest form of jihad was peaceful worship of God Almighty, which they were envisaging in Medina. Allah says, أُذِنَ لِلَّذِينَ يُقَاتَلُونَ بِأَنَّهُمْ ظُلِمُوا, that permission to fight back is granted only to those against whom war has been declared. Jihad is not for everybody, and that even the smallest jihad. The jihad of defensive combat is a permission which is granted exclusively to such people against whom war has been declared and in defense. Then Allah says, وَقَاتِلُوا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ الَّذِينَ يُقَاتَلُونَكُمْ وَلَا تَعْتَدُوا, fight only those people in the way of God who fight you. Which means clearly that you cannot initiate violence, you cannot initiate fighting. Then Allah says, فَإِنْ قَاتَلُوكُمْ فَاقْتَلُوهُمْ, fight them only if they fight you. So you see, again and again, the same thing has been highlighted. The defense, it is only in defense that you are allowed, you are permitted to conduct the jihad of defensive combat. I have not seen this movie and I have no desire to. But from what I've gathered from sources and from the internet, this individual has raised certain objections and has made some allegations. One of them appears to be slave trade. He suggests through this movie that the Prophet ﷺ was in any way involved in slave trade. Now, to put it very politely, this is absolutely rubbish. The Prophet ﷺ never possessed a slave. At the age of 25, he was married to a lady named Khadija radiallahu anha. Hazrat Khadija radiallahu anha did have slaves in her possession, which was perfectly in line with the custom of those times. The first thing the Prophet did was he freed all those slaves. So slave trade is something which comes nowhere in the Prophet's life. The filmmaker is evidently ignorant of the Prophet's life, and all that he has tried to depict is his own imagination, his own fantasies. He has created an imaginary Muhammad, and he has created a film around this imagination of his. Another allegation, that the Holy Prophet ﷺ married his daughter-in-law. The lady in question, Zainab bint Jahash, was married to Zaid bin Haris. As the name suggests, Zaid bin Haris means Zaid, son of Haris, right? So Zainab bint Jahash would if she is anybody's daughter-in-law, she is the daughter-in-law of Mr. Harris, not of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This marriage unfortunately turned out to be an unhappy one and ended in a divorce. So the daughter-in-law of Mr. Harris, who was the father of Zaid bin Harris, was divorced by Zaid bin Harris, and then she was no longer the daughter-in-law of Mr. Harris. The Holy Prophet felt responsible, and in fulfilling his responsibility to the lady who had just been divorced, who also happened to be his first cousin, he proposed to her and offered his hand in marriage to her, which she gladly accepted, and she became the wife of the Holy Prophet. This unfortunate filmmaker has also tried to raise doubts on the issue of the death penalty of Kinana bin Rabi. Now, this has to be clearly understood. Kinana bin Rabi used to live in Medina. He was guilty of cold-blooded murder of a person named Mahmud. Kinana bin Rabi had killed Mahmud in cold blood. It was what we call first-degree murder, for which Kinana bin Rabi was awarded the death penalty. He fled from Medina to Khaybar. Right? On the occasion of the fall of Khaybar, he was aware of his previously committed crime, and the death penalty was given. It was due and it was executed, and Kinana bin Rabi was put to death, something he deserved. I mean, why was Timothy McVeigh put to death? He was put to death because he was guilty of murder. Kinana bin Rabi was married to a lady named Safiya. After the death of Kinana bin Rabi, the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam offered his hand in marriage to Safiya. Interestingly, Safiya had some time back seen a dream in which she had been told. I mean, this the glad tidings had been given to her that she would be married to the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And when she narrated this dream of hers to her then husband Kinana bin Rabi, she was physically brutally beaten by her husband. So it was not exactly a case of a happily wedded couple. When her husband was given the death penalty, which he had earned long time back, and died, the Prophet offered his hand in marriage, which she very gladly accepted. And it turned out to be a marriage of great affection, mutual affection, great mutual love. On the issue of slavery, we have to bear in mind that if there is any religious scripture that promotes the abolition of slavery, it is the Holy Quran. The Imam of the Ahmadiyya Jamaat, Hazrat Khalifatul Masih V, has advised Ahmadis and all Muslims to respond to such blasphemy by praying for the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If people insult the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we respond by praying for the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We pray to God to exalt the station of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We pray to God to shower his choicest blessings upon the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So I end with this prayer, Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa ala ali Muhammad, Mubarak wa sallim.